also Jim has kind of look regular scientific CV that I'm going to describe. Although very successful, there is much more to tell about. After a BC in China, he moved to Cambridge to do his PhD, and after postdoc in Harvard with Lee J. Corey, he was starting his academic career in Brandeis University as an assistant professor. In 2007, he moved to the Scripps Research Institute, and in 2010, became a full professor. He has a long list of awards already. I'm not going to mention all your awards, maybe just one that for me look significant. This is the Mukoyama Award for the Society of Organic Synthesis, given in Japan. But Gene has established himself as one of the key figures in the field of CH bond activations. And to understand a little bit about Gene, I have to tell you a couple of more sentences without a piece of paper. So in one of my last visits in Scripps, I was sitting in his office and I was asking him about his childhood. And I was trying to understand where this person came from. So I was sitting in his computer and opening Google Maps, saying, show me where is your village in China. He said, no, Google Maps cannot find it. It's too isolated. This was too much. I really needed to understand. What do you mean too isolated? We are now in San Diego. Explain to me how do you get to your home in China. So this is simple. We take a flight. We fly to Beijing. Then we take another internal flight. Then we take a train for several hours. Then a bus for a couple of hours. Then we reach a lake. We take a canoe. We paddle for like half an hour. Then walk 5 miles, climb a mountain, and over there, this is my place of birth. So it's not really a village. It is an isolated home that he was living at. That's what I understood. So, and where do you get food? We grow our food. That's what we're saying. I think the age of 13, he was most of the time at home growing his own food. They had, did you have animals? He said, yeah, we had one pig. Why just one? Because we didn't have enough food to feed more than one pig. So this is where Gene started. At age 13, he left home. Leaving home to go to study is different concept than what we are used to think of. You're leaving a home 500 kilometers away from your home, and you stay in what he called a school, which is a small building, and you learn there, you sleep there, you eat there. What do you eat, I ask him? Rice. What do you mean, just rice? Say, yes, just rice. Maybe some salt sometimes he has. And even some beans, pickles that he was adding as vitamins. So his major breakthrough came when he was an undergraduate student, a kind of a master student, doing research already. And at this stage, in such an early stage, you discover already industrial process, a chemical reaction that served the industrial very significantly. This is something regards a process that is using a shampoo, a compound that is using a shampoo formulation. The process was so successful that recently a competitive factory in Florida had to be shut down because of this discovery. And this discovery actually gave him the opportunity to get a very prestigious scholarship and then to move to England. And from there, his scientific way continued and rise up. So I think it's really important to understand a bit about his history in order to see where the science that he's going to present now is leading to. So with this gene, I would like you to present your stuff. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Don, for that very kind introduction. But mostly, thank you for leaving me a few minutes to talk about my chemistry. I was very nervous, but you're going to finish most of it. Anyhow, so first of all, let me join all the speakers in thanking the organizer, and particularly for me, it's a great honor to be here, and it's a tremendous honor. I really appreciate it, but I think I really most appreciate the second component of this award, as the President mentioned, from Dr. Sacklin and Mr. Sacklin, that is the encouragement component. Because this field is still struggling, and we need a lot of encouragement. And I believe that Melanie would agree with me. We have so many problems, and all we need is encouragement. And I think that's a very precious gift I will take all the way to my lab, to my student, in addition to the big check, of course, yeah. Well, so, yeah, and also I think before I start talking my chemistry, I do want to congratulate all the speakers for their absolutely wonderful talk. Usually I fall asleep, especially when I travel internationally. I have a very bad, difficult problem to keep awake. But today I didn't have any heavy eyes. It was totally amazing lecture. So congratulations to everybody for coming here. So let me try to see what message I can deliver, because now probably most of you are already very tired. So let me just emphasize in the very beginning, all I want you to remember from this lecture is very simple. Is the single most important challenge in our lab, at least we are totally focused on this one problem. That is, how do we discover a new approach? Or more specifically, a magic ligand, as you already probably noticed from Barry's talk, all those magic ligands he's using for his analytic chemistry and synthesis. How do we discover that magic ligand? That would accelerate CH-act cleavage process by precisely lowering the transition state of that step, that one step, not after or not before. Of course, it would be better if you can do all of them, but we really want to focus just on that one step. Can we lower the transition state? And here you see the question, but I have to apologize. I'm not going to give you a definite answer today. But I want to emphasize is by asking the right question, even if you don't have the answer, that can take you to the right places. And that, again, I think Barry already alluded. That is a sharp contrast between the random screening approach, library screening, and a hypothesis-driven approach. Okay, they can take you to new places that other approach may not take you. And hopefully you can make your own judgment whether it's entropy or enthalpy by the end of my talk. And another point I want to make is I want briefly tell you that what we are interested in. We are very focused in new disconnection. Melanie is interested in both fields, synthesis and Mersenne. At the moment, we are really most focused on new disconnection. And here's one example that we really started out. This is our first project back then, Cambridge University, as Doran said, 2002. We were interested in taking aliphatic acid and develop synthetic methodology. And here are a few examples. You see palladium insertion. And you may wonder why we chose palladium insertion. I think today I don't need to give any introduction. This is Melanie already gave a great talk on that reason. And I think you can see clearly from the early discovery of history from Barry's talk. Because carbon plating is magic. You can pretty much turn that into anything. And in a moment I will show you. But if you look at this scheme, immediately you can see the problems. The problem is based on the classic functional group manipulation Melanie already hinted. But I think the big difference is if you are operating on a functional group, usually you're dealing with one. Rarely you have to deal with two or three, although that is an interesting problem for double bond. If you have 10 double bond, how do you distinguish them as a problem? But for CH bond, you cannot get away from that because everywhere is CH bond. You have so many to distinguish. So that's a big problem. And even worse, compared to Mersenne, I would argue this is even more difficult. Because now, because in the presence of this functional group, each CH bond now are different, and yet they are very subtly different. But they have one common feature, that is, poor reactivity, and yet they're different electronically, geometrically. But that also means opportunity. Why? Because if you break any of the CH bond differently, then they will present you with a different structure, depending on what synthesis you're making. In other words, you pretty much can plan your synthesis based on one starting material, if you can break a different CH bond. That is the power. But of course, that has to be relying on control of the regional selectivity, which I'll tell you one example today. How do we control the distance? And the enantiomer selectivity, how do you control that? Because remember, this is an sp3 center. It's like slippery fish, very difficult to grab them. It's sp3, free rotating. Barry also mentioned you have this one mechanism for hydrogenation, you have a pi phase selectivity, and that's a very good introduction for me too. Here, how do you develop a mechanism? How do you control the sp center from sp3 center? It's like just like slippery fish. The conformation is free to rotate. So that's a huge problem. Okay. But of course, if somehow you can do all of that, plus one more, if you can do diverse catalysis here as well, turn this carbon plating bond into whatever you want, then you're really in good shape, right? And I don't want, of course, repeating what Melanie's transformation, the Gould transformation. I just want to impress you that even by one group, by just my student, we can do all of that already. And this is a checklist. Last week we checked this boron or phosphate. This will come out soon. And boron we finished last month. That is the two. Turns out to be the most difficult one for us. But we just want to do all of them, okay? And I can tell you the blue part, the blue arrow means it's still very difficult. But the black part, we are very confident that we can do really well. Broad scope and very high turnover, I'll show you. Actually, this iodination is a new breakthrough. We always struggle iodination. We published 10 papers now, but none of them, according to Barry Sharpless, are useful. Okay, it's a great colleague, right? To be very, very harsh on you, and it's very telling you what to do as well. But now we have an iodination method, I will tell you, it's really practical, ready for ton scale in production. Okay, very cheap, very, very interesting catalysis. So before then, I move on to really focus on the ligand acceleration and the CH cleavage reactivity part, cytoselectivity part. I just want to very briefly mention the catalysis, although this may be redundant today because Melanie already did a great job, but I will still give you a brief introduction. What are the choices do you have in terms of catalysis, right? The first one is 2,4, as Melanie already beautifully said, but let me just repeat the two points that she might have already said. One is the problem is what kind of oxygen you can use to oxidize the platelet 2,4, quite often expensive, as she said. Another one is too reactive. If you're doing total synthesis, you don't want the background reaction to be reactive. If you want to do an antiselective reaction, you can't have a reactive oxygen because the background reaction will be a big problem, and you will see that in my talk. Okay, so you need a very practical oxygen that's inert, but somehow you have a ligand to promote that reactivity. That would be the idea. Second problem is the selectivity in the reductive elimination problem. And this actually, Vigilov did a lot of beautiful study before, at the same time when we started, basically, 2003, Vigilov published a seminal work, studied the channel fluoride promoting reductive elimination CC bond formation. And we were thinking about just doing functionalization, of course. And the selectivity is a huge problem because from this plating 4, you quite often have three choices to form a new bond, right? And let me just tell you what we've done. The first really interesting discovery made from our laboratory was this peroxide. Very cheap, very stable, but unfortunately too stable, not reactive enough. So far, the reaction we have developed only two reactors. So it's very limited scope, as well as subject scope is very limited. But this has a great future because it's very safe, very easy to use, but not great so far. Another one is very simple iodine. Although early days we published a lot of papers, as I hinted already, iodine acetate, we generate from all kinds of ways. But iodine is the dream oxygen. But the key is how do you develop a ligand can turn this over. You can see that problem. If you have iodine, you can oxidize the platelet 2,4 according to Candy's chemistry and Van Cotten's chemistry. But then you form the product. But at the same time, you generate platelet iodide bond, strong bond. If you do turn over twice, you would be precipitating platelet iodide, beautiful crystal come out. And we have that in our lab all the time. But it's useless. It doesn't do anything. So you really need to exchange that out with a ligand to form a catalytic. It's just iodine. And the beautiful point for using iodine is, of course, because iodine is not reactive in many cases. And that's why we can do enantioselective CH iodination. And in a moment, you will see that. And the catalytic turnover so far, the best one is 200 turnover, meaning you can use 0.5 mole percent platelet and just throw the iodine, which is very easy to use. Another catalysis that probably we spend most of the time, and that's what you are going to be seeing most of the reaction I'll show you today, is platelet 2,0. And it's kind of favorite, but it's very hard to say. This favorite can change. But at the moment, it's this very simple one, platelet 2 cleave the CH bond. Then the dream is, can you then couple with wider range of nucleophile or electrophile? And then you try to promote the CC bond, CN bond, CO bond. Hopefully, CO bond is still difficult, but with a ligand, it's possible to generate platelet 0. Then you can turn this over, use just air, ideally, okay? And we like this catalysis because for the first time, we believe this made a very nice connection between CH activation and Suzuki coupling. Because Suzuki coupling, of course, you don't need to be convinced, it's very useful. But now, you can just use CH bond as a substrate, and yet you can do Suzuki coupling. So you can have hundreds of reactions, depending on what Suzuki coupling partner you can use. And for some time, we have kind of written off this catalysis. Our group was very hesitant to get involved in this catalysis. Actually, this one is the most extensively studied in the history. So it's 1970s, 1980s, from Japan, and then from Europe. Many, many beautiful papers published. But we were kind of have, for good reason, I will explain to you why we were not interested in this catalysis. But this has changed. Because the catalysis is beautiful. You start from platelet 0, And then you do oxidative addition, you generate that palladium 2. Then you do another CH activation, you do a CC bond, and then you regenerate palladium 0. If the student are not familiar with this catalysis, I suggest you just view this as a hexagram. That's the best way to look at this chemistry. Except that this second coupling partner here, CH bond, if it's an aromatic CH bond, it's almost like a double bond. But the catalysis is beautiful, just like a hex. You don't need to worry about closing the catalysis, right? But the biggest problem in terms of reactivity, in terms of what we want to do to design a ligand to accelerate the CH activation, there's a huge problem. Because before the CH activation happens, you already loaded, really loaded the plating with a ligand, particular ligand you may not want, you may not like. You have also loaded the another substrate partner, aryl halide. It's almost, you tell someone to run 100 meters, 9 seconds, but you already have 100 kilos of rice on his back, asking him to run. Okay, so the plating is not going to do very well, reactivity. Of course, you may do very well, but they may not, depending what they are. So that's limiting what you can design. And also, there's no vacant site enough for you to play, to design a ligand. So for a long time, we didn't like this. And I have to acknowledge in this field, the major player died, but all those chemistry can be read in this review. It's really early, early or more recent, 1990s by Dyke, and then more recent, I would say, in this generation, his family spent a lot of time trying to get this to work. But basically, for SP3 CH activation, pretty much not much progress, in my opinion. It's only intramolecular tested reaction, okay? For a long time, we thought this is not going to really make it for SP3. But it turns out we were wrong. This catalysis is very interesting. This is the second example we've done. Even the alkyne plating, you can still cleave the SP3CH bond. But we will come back to the original metal reactivity, hopefully, not in detail, but maybe I will touch upon that. But most of the time, you just need to remember this 2-0 catalysis. And most of the time, you still, if I'm still not clear enough about catalysis, you can really throw them out of the window and just focus on the reactivity that I'm going to show you upon. And that is about substrate. What kind of substrate we can do, okay? So the first selection is very clear. It's based on the whatever the criteria you've seen many talks from Enon's talk, ready available, the starting with benzoic acid. And that means you can buy from Aldrich for $1 one kilo, but also the diversity. Because if you want diversity, you can buy maybe 500 from, if you do a science finder, you can have 500 of this kind of benzoic acid substrate. That means really available. And then benzoamine, benzyl alcohol, or aliphatic acid. All of those are great. But then you realize that's not enough. And that is, whatever you do, the new function group and the existing function group, the relationship is always the same in terms of distance. And that would limit the synthetic application. So it's very important to have some luxury in terms of distance, right? To move the function group away, now you have a distance, meaning the CH bond is not the same anymore. Well, it's still orthal here, but the distance tells you the structure you can make is totally different. And let me explain that. If you want to make an indole, you need a 2-carbon here. And that turns out to be very challenging. And we are the first group to show how to make indole by this long range, relatively long range CH activation. If you want to make iso or quinoline, then you need even one more carbon. And that, again, it has been very difficult, right? Because the distance is too long. And the coordination is very weak because we don't have a strong coordinating group here. It's a simple protein group or simple function group. And all of those may need a ligand. So those clearly are the challenge. How do we do that? Those chemistry are certainly is not working when we started clearly. But there's another problem. The blue CH bond. And that ortho CH bond. What about if you want to cut the CH bond somewhere else? Not even ortho. How do we do that? And that, again, I'll show you. We have some preliminary results to show you should be able to do that as well, practically. But let's look into the literature, and perhaps I'm repeating some of the Melanie's references here. Basically, SP3 CH activation, they have been beautifully shown by inorganic chemistry chemists. Bernard Shaw is definitely my hero from University of Leeds in England, and this is a beautiful chemistry, and this is from Japan, and I should have another example 1980s later, though, from Italy, and that's oxazolone chemistry as well. But none of those clearly has a chiral environment. So what do we really want to do by looking at those all of those chemistry, beautiful chemistry, but as you can see, you cannot plug in those chemistry into what we wanted to do. None of those can be relevant to the substrate. So what we want to do is to study this reaction, but from a different angle that has not been available. That is stereochemistry as a physical organic tool. Believe it or not, many of my mentors believe that stereochemistry still is the most powerful mechanistic tool to really peek into the details of the transition state. And this is what we did. Early days in 2003, we spent a lot of time in Cambridge growing many crystal structures. And let me tell you, why But many of those crucifixes didn't necessarily tell us much of information except this one. When we look at this crucifix structure, one thing striking is you can do this C-hybridization at 0 degree. Okay, and the question is why? Then we started to do kinetics. We started to do NOE study, and we look at the crucifix structure. One thing is very clear. That is, if you change the sterics here, tertiobutyl to isopropyl, this reaction needs 100 degree, give you 10% yield. But if you just place the tertiobutyl here, that's 0 degree, 100% yield. And 99 EEs, if the substrate is right. Okay? So that tells you something. The coordination may not be, the coordination is the same. But the coordination strength may not be required in these cases. Instead, it's the conformation that is most important. And what we believe is the dihedral angle between the palladium acetate and the CH bond has to be minimum within 20 degrees based on our data to have maximum speed for CH activation. And that translates to the CMD mechanism, which was first proposed by Martinez in 1980s, 1990s, the so-called deprotonation mechanism. Okay. And of course, this was confirmed later by Ken Hart. And you can tell by correlating all the steric model conformation to the detailed reactivity kinetic data, as well as the stereochemistry, basically you can use Ken Hawk's model predict within 5% error of the enantioselectivity activity we can obtain, the disteric we can obtain. And that gives us a lot of confidence to support this kind of model. Okay, the conformation indeed is very important. But then the question practically is, how do you do that without using a solvent? That became immediate hypothesis, right? So the question is, how do you do that if you use carboxy acid? These are the problems. This is the one structure that's not going to be productive. You knew that, and that's the major species. But the good news is, as you heard from Barry, 10% is enough if the reactive species is 10%, right? The 90% is non-productive. And this is non-productive. And this one is okay, but not efficient. As you can see, all those pioneering works, they are working on this one structure because it's floppy. The entropic cost is still too big. So the inspiration all really came from this single thought, is a crystal structure deposited in chemistry database. The sodium coordinated very nicely with this carboxylic acid. So the question is, can this structure mimic the oxazoline, and then the palladium can grab the known pair, like a rabbit ear, from the other side. One of the ear is grabbed by the palladium, and that would assemble the structure, presumably minimize the entropy to assemble the pre-transition state. Okay, and that of course works, but except for the student, it's not easy. It took only 3 years to get this to work. But let me show you what he did. Mix the substrate with palladium acetate, and you can hit whatever you want. No reaction would happen except decarboxylation. But if you just walk to the kitchen, get one spoon table salt, you would get quantitative CH activation. And to my knowledge, I think, this is the first really firm example suggesting weak coordination is very powerful for directing palladiation into CH bond. And you might wonder what took us 3 years. It turns out this is like a plate in black. You cannot isolate this dissolving any solvent unless DMSO. But DMSO will kill the CH formation. You can't see it. So basically it forms like plate in black, like on the reaction flask. You have to really break them and then dissolve them in DMSO and clean them, and you get this pure compound. Now the big question is this useful? This may not be useful. They may not do catalysis. It turns out if you look at this diagram, it's very clear. So before the carboxy acid chemistry, the oxazoline chemistry, what we're doing is we're driving the thermodynamics thing to here through directing CH activation. And it's great, you can do some reaction. But clearly the energy barrier here can be very high. Of course, I'm exaggerating this mountain because the rate limiting step could still be here, depending if you have a good CH activation. The rate limiting step may well be here. But for the student, this is a huge mountain. Why? Because before you discover the conditions, this is impossible. You don't have the reaction. Forget about which rate limiting step. You have zero, right? That means this is a psychological huge barrier as well. So by providing this weak coordination, clearly you're pushing this over to give you a lot of opportunity to discover. And indeed, I think since that idea, I think many of the reactions, including many I will show you, are discovered the first time by using this approach. Then you can go back to use to develop many other directors who use many other metals. They have benefited from the conditions from here, including solvent combination or oxygen, okay? And here is the table, a small collection. And let me just point out a few. Cross-coupling was first discovered by oxazoline and pyridine. But certainly sp3 oligomination was discovered first by the weak coordination. The hydroxylation was discovered first by this weak coordination, boronation, even amination, I would say intermolecular amination, through palladium 2,4, I'm not quite sure. I think stoichiometry many have demonstrated something, but I think for For the benzoate amide, definitely that was might be the first example for intermite. Okay, so definitely there's a lot of examples that the weak coordination can help you a lot in terms of developing reactions. But what is really most interesting is the weak coordination can break away from the distance. And that is, if you think about it, that's not surprising. Because it's already very weak coordination, the conditions you develop is already capable of capitalizing the weak coordination. So why bother? If it's a little bit more weaker, maybe you can still do it. That was the basic thinking. And indeed, that works. And let me give you one example, extraordinary example, the ether. That is very weak. But still, you can do that. Except I have to admit, you still have to wait for the real condition. You need a ligand to accelerate as well, to help a little bit. But without ligand, it still works, 30% yield. With a ligand, 80% yield. And the YRA amide also works, but again, that is a ligand. Otherwise, the yield is still low. But still, this tells you the distance, the weak coordination, it's all, you can throw them out of the window. You can deal with it. It's not a big problem anymore. But of course, it's a huge limitation, still. Although this will be very useful, it is a huge limitation. But let me show you the usefulness first. This is a natural product I've made. This is MD Myers chemistry. This apparently is 20 gram already finished. They may scale up when they hit clinical phase 2, but it's used as a weak coordination hydroxylation. And this is functional use style chemistry. This is 20 gram scale as well, if you read the paper very carefully. And of course, most impressively, Phil Bannery finished this molecule. He already alluded, but he was very brief. Actually, he made a huge library, 40 library, using our chemistry to diversify them as well in the late stage, final step. Okay. And of course, I just give you one example of BMS using this chemistry, but there are many. Okay. There are many, many examples that they have used our chemistry in drug discovery. This is in a drug discovery project. But clearly, there are still limitations. But before, actually, I get ahead of myself. Actually, before I talk about the limitation, I do want to show you the ligand acceleration first. Okay. So those reactions are great, but we are not still not happy because the turnover is not great. We are looking for ligand. We still don't have a stereo control, regio selection control, so we need to develop a ligand. But the first idea was to search for a ligand that would be clearly involved in the transition state of the CH cleavage. But how do you do that? Because if you have a ligand, you can do CH activation, but you don't know whether they're helping second, third step, or the first step. So we needed to observe some enantiomer activity as a proof of principle, although you can never guarantee, but it's as good as we can get. So this is what we set up the reaction to screen, and believe me, this is not a strong coordination because of the sterics, these two sterics, and because of the distance. This cyclomethylation actually is very, not as stable as the other one at all. It's very reactive, and that's why we can do very mild condition cross-coupling. But the challenge clearly is this. How do you match the substrate with the ligand. As you can see, that immediately what's going to happen is two substrates coordinate to the plating. And that immediately gives you a problem, right? Because you don't have a ligand. Or, if the ligand is too strong, you have the two ligands coordinate the plating. Okay? And finally, what you need is to assemble the directing group and the ligand together and to have a good party, right? And that is possible, as Barry said, but it's not easy, for sure. Particularly in some of the substrate, if you want to do SP3 or aromatic CH activation, clearly it's not easy. Perhaps what's even more obvious is, if you look into history, how many asymmetric CH activation asymmetric methods by plating you can point your fingers to that is really useful? There's only one. We heard it this morning. There's not even a good second, in my opinion. Maybe I'm wrong, Barry. But I think really useful. There's only one example. That is this talk that we heard this morning. That tells you something. That plating is not necessarily the best metal to do that, probably. Or that's the wrong way to say it. It's just very difficult because the coordinating side is very limited to some extent. You only have four to some extent, right? If you need a substrate, then you need a reactivity. You can't have too many choices. That is definitely a problem, at least in our experience, okay? I might be wrong. But let me cut a long story short. Eventually, what we came up with is this supermolecular structure, self-assembled, basically. We have to admit, we did not design exactly this ligand. We will design a completely different model. But that doesn't necessarily convince me to give up the rational design approach. I still think this came out from the rational design, even if it's not exactly what we designed. So let me walk you through the structure. Very simple monoprotective amino acid coordinated with plating through bisdentate. And the bisdentate coordination is extremely important because although it's very weak coordinating so that we can maintain, the plating is very reactive. But at the same time, entropically, kinetically, this is a very strong coordination so that you don't lose the coordination to the substrate. That's number one. Number two, through the sterics, through the coordination structure, they prevent the substrate from one side, from this side, the front side. They can only come in from the behind. And that's very important because otherwise you get racemic. So you have to control from one side. And secondly, what's important is the bisdentate is that fixed the stereochemistry. Through the bisdentate, you really make this color center rigid so that the isobutyl, like LeBron James, they can elbow the bulk down straight. No competition here. They really push them down. So the end bulk is really blocking this side. And that we think is influencing when the CH bond approaching from the bottom or from the top. Okay, and that controls the stereochemistry. So it's very different to the pi phase or whatever the facial selectivity C2. This is not a C2 ligand. Okay, so that's the difference. And this really works. Okay, and I'll show you the result. This is the first example, 95% EE catalytically. And that is an esoteric substrate, I agree, but it doesn't work with carboxy acid. That's more useful now. And of course, it also works with cyclopropane. That's not quite an sp3, but it's very encouraging, isn't it? Because that's a real substrate. You can do Suzuki coupling, make a power center, two power center assemble in one part. That is very useful. And you can do so in large quantity, in large number of cross coupling number. Vinyl coupling, now we're finished. You can do vinyl, you can do alkyl, so you can make a lot of cyclopropane. But it's always interesting to see other people using it. That is more convincing. And this is a very nice chemistry plate 2-4 by my former student just in starting his independent career. You can see he can do CO bond formation. And I hope many would agree with me. This is a great example to tell you the detailed information of the platinum 2-4 oxidation. This basically throughout the window, this platinum 2-4 dimer, whatever, I think it's definitely monomer. Okay? There's no way that this ligand can tolerate, can accommodate that dimer to the oxidation. This is very clear it's a dimer. Although we dare not to claim in our paper, but maybe Melanie can help us. Yeah, definitely this is a monomer, okay? And here's another reaction, iodination, I already mentioned. By taking the simple triphamide, you can do enantioselective selective amination, 97 EE up to, okay? And the temperature is 30 degrees. And you use only iodine because of the ligand. And that's the best option so far I can imagine that you can do multi-ton scale production. Maybe you worry about the turnover. Well, actually, the turnover can use 0.5 mole if you raise it to 60 degrees, except EE suffers from 85 to 90. That's the difference. But the turnover in principle, you can improve to very high level. I remember when I showed this result to Barry Sharpless, he said, wow, this is the best practical chemistry that so far you have done. But I knew what he mean. He meant that the other stuff you are doing is totally useless. I knew what he mean. But that's a great encouragement anyway. I knew what we have to do. Okay. But anyhow, the third example, let me show you, is again from other group, okay, using Suzuki coupling that we developed the reaction to zero catalysis, and using the ligand as well. Now you can do Suzuki coupling, making this very difficult planar chiral ligand or base for many, many years. And this is very difficult chiral ligand to make. But now you can make a huge library just using one step cross coupling. You can pretty much make 100 a week if you want to do it, just Suzuki coupling. Okay, so that is all the application. And I don't do a justice to all those other people who have used this ligand, beautiful chemistry. At least there are 20 groups now have used this chemistry, ligand, to do this cross coupling chemistry. In terms of mechanism, I don't think we have a final answer, but I'll show you one insight that we have. This is the structure we can identify from the solution, and this is the intermediate we identify from the solution. What we didn't know is what's going on in between. And by computation study, I should say it's all done by myself and Ken Hawk recently. Myself discovered the first step is NH bond activation. I remember Barry in my office when I showed him, he was very skeptical about the NH bond. So you are right, it is clean, okay? But I remember you were having a big problem that why this existed. So this is clean. Exactly, we don't see that because that's the precursor. We don't see what's going on afterwards, okay? But now you are right, it's clean. And I remember E.J. Corey and John Hartley all had a problem with that. So that is clear. So that's just a brief kind of overview of the mechanism. But let me show you the real result. What's the matter? Why ligand matters? Because the ligand can accelerate CH activation. As Melanie said, it's very important to have air as an oxygen. And here's the best example. Use air, you do alternation, use this ligand, 0.2 mole percent, you can still do this reaction. And you can, if you really want to be fast, 2% mole palladium, 20 minutes, the reaction is finished. That means this reactivity is already on par with HEC reaction. I don't know anyone has run a HEC reaction in 20 minutes. It's a very fast reaction. Okay? I mean, you don't need 20 minutes, but it's just to show you that this reactivity is really hot, really good. Each step is promoted by this ligand. Okay? And Kiri Ingle actually was the student who was responsible for that, and I should thank Melanie for teaching him and sending him to my lab as a great, wonderful graduate student. He's going to go up for a postdoc. And if you're still not convinced about the weak coordination and the kinetics where ligand is accelerating, this is Donald Brackman's study. Shows clearly the catalytic reaction is only one order on catalyst. Only catalyst matters. Zero order on substrate. And that makes a lot of sense, right? Because if your substrate weak coordination is sufficient, then you should see zero order. And it's negative order on double bond. That also makes a lot of sense. Because double bond is competing for the weak coordination. And so everything, you can see the huge acceleration, right? Flat. Without ligand, it's flat. With ligand, you shoot up with the first 20 minutes very quickly. So the ligand definitely is a perfect ligand, basically. And of course, once you have that kind of reaction, clearly you can find application because the substrate is so readily available, so representative, phenylacetic acid. We made all those precursor key. Actually, that's the natural product itself as well. In all those cases, we made a 10-gram scale in the paper probably just to demonstrate that it's cheap to run, it's easy to make. Okay. And of course, you still have to make a molecule in scripts. At least my colleagues always encourage me to do so to demonstrate that the chemistry is actually useful. So in this case, we selected this lysospermic acid because it's a promising anti-HIV actually target, agent. So we selected this molecule to try to demonstrate, can we do this direct to the CH alkylation at the final step of a synthesis? That would really providing you a convergent step, a synthesis that you cannot do before. If you want to do that, you have to put a bromine here. That is not easy. It's not a one-step saving. It's saving many, many steps. You can't put a bromine here. Even if you made the bromo, it turns out the head coupling doesn't work. They really readily decompose this fragment. So you really need the right pH value, need the right temperature, and a fast reaction time to keep the color center really untouched to get this product. And the ligand was the key. This ligand here was the key to finish this total synthesis, of course. But that was not exactly the perfect synthesis, because the beginning couple of steps, certainly I remember Phil Barron was not so impressed with the first 7 steps. He thinks you can cut that to 5 steps, but we don't know how to do that. So instead, we decided to develop something else. So we cut that first couple of steps all the way back to here. We know how to put that together. So now the question is how to make that one, because this one you can buy, very readily available, natural product based. So we decided to develop another hydroxylation, alkoxylation reaction to close this ring. And then this way arrive at this very simple beta hydroxyl carboxylic acid. And that can be made in collaboration with Hugh Davis in natural selectively 96% EE, the 70% yield in this step. So basically by doing 3 steps from this very simple building block, you can make this advanced intermediate. And this route has already been applied by Professor Ghosh in Purdue for anti-HIV agent. It's published now already, just coming out, using exactly the same chemistry here. That tells you, again, this chemistry has been used, okay, by other group for total synthesis. And I jumped ahead before, and that, because I can't wait to jump ahead to tell you about the limitation. And here's the limitation, you see. Those chemistry are great, are beautiful, but they will, I think, help us statistically will be 30% of the cases you will find those very useful. There are another 60%. It's a different story. And that are this, many already have said, non-direct situation, but we are not kind of trying to develop one catalyst for every subject. We have been very realistic, or humble, I should say. We decided to divide the subject class into 3 classes here I showed you. One class is electron deficient subject. So we try to exploit the electron density at the C3, which is a little bit high. Another one is the electron rich at the para. We try to exploit the electron density here. And the third one is a pyridine. And pyridine is a very special subject for medicinal chemistry. And Phil has a great method to do the C2. But the C3 need a different method. And we knew that electron density sits on the C3, but that's not a problem. The problem is the strong coordination from the pyridine to palladium catalyst. So we really need another catalyst that would somehow, through sterics, through electronically, they would weaken this coordination and make them reversible. I don't remember whether Elon or Barry said that. Making them reversible is a good thing. And that is exactly what we did. We made the pyridine coordinate palladium very rapidly reversible. And then you can have a chance because it tumble. The molecule can tumble. Like a fish swimming, then you hit the head or hit the tail. Right? If you hit the tail, you got it. Okay, so that's exactly what it is. Okay. So, but finally, there's another class of substrate that's even more difficult, and I think Melanie has already kind of touched upon that problem. That is, what about if you have a phenylpyridine? You can direct to that, which is a beautiful chemistry. I don't think we should apologize for that, because in many cases, pharmaceuticals use it. It's very good chemistry. But what about if you want this one? So we use that ligand to do this one. But what about if you use that one? That's tough. Because this is a weak coordinating, that is strong coordinating, it's a perfect reaction. How do you design a ligand to accelerate that step through the transition state, but weaken that coordination and prevent that? If you have all of those two combined, you basically can play a lot in medicinal chemistry. And I can tell you the good news is we can do both of this in 95% yield, and hopefully you will read them very quickly. This is with a special ligand design. But that's not what I'm going to talk about. What I will tell you about, the first part of my talk anyway, SP2, is another problem, probably even more difficult. That is a remote CH elevation, where you have this function group that's remote to the CH bond, and so you don't have the bias, the electronic bias. You have no handle, because all those five CH bonds now are equivalent. So you can't distinguish them. They're like twins. How do you distinguish them? And also, you cannot reach the metal ones through coordination, even if it's a weak and non-distance, because this cyclophane transition state is highly strained. It's unlikely. They would go for the author, if anything you can do, with the ligand acceleration. So that is another problem. Furthermore, to complicate this, if you're a synthetic chemist like Phil, sometimes you never know what you want. In this case, maybe you want a mesoxynol here. Then you have a huge problem, because the mesoxynol will push the electron density to the power. The CF3 will govern at the metal. How do you override them? Because all you need is predictability. And that, again, is the beautiful chemistry you hear from Barry's chemistry. It looks very simple, but it's the predictability that allows him to make 300 natural products. Because he can predict. When you look at the structure, you know, okay, that's what I'm going to do. You predict what's going to happen, what E you can get, where you're going to go, which is activity. So you want something that you can go in and predict the relationship, the distance, and recognize them like a molecular recognition to control the CH activity. And to make it even more difficult, what about if the ring is naked, has nothing, but the function will be somewhere else? Then you're talking about side selectivity, like Scott-Miller, for hydroxyl protection. How do you recognize them? But if you draw this molecule through a complication, actually to tell you one thing, the distances are the same. They all have a common. They are all basically 12 bonds, 13 bonds away. So can you recognize that bond distance by design something to recognize them with very high fidelity? Then you're in business. But the fun, I don't have time to show you for the second example. I do have one example for the second part, the non-directive. Basically, this is a mutual repulsive ligand to make this mono-dentate, a mono-pyridine coordinated plating. This is the idea. And that led to this meta-selective CH formulation. But the man is right. This is not a great reaction yet. It's very limited in terms of surface scope and also turnover. But what I really want to tell you, of course, is a different story. It's a remote CH formulation. What's the problem? The problem is so far we have been always working on directed cyclic transition state. Basically, that's all inspired by the lithiation chemistry. Okay, Peter Beaker, Sneaker's chemistry. How do we do cyclophane transition state? Maybe we don't do it. Instead, focusing on that transition state, what I told my students is to forget about the transition state in this case. Just view maybe the palladium catalyst and your substrate as a two little very vibrant fish. But somehow, if you put them in a little pond, let them swim randomly, and if they hit each other, and then if you have a ligand, maybe they can catch each other somewhere. Be visual selective, because your ligand might tell them to do something, visual selectively. So you don't try to assemble that rigid structure. That was the idea. But how do you test that kind of idea? So in the beginning, it's very awkward. We designed this very complex template. Let me walk you through the idea. The red part is flat. That's number one component. It has to be flat. So everything you attach to that template is more or less on the same plane. That's very important. Second one, we engineer the sterics, the two R group, to push the substrate and potentially the catalyst into the same coordinate. If you remember high school math, right? 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the coordinate 4. So that's the pond. Now you have two fish in the little pond. Let them swim. Let them fight. Maybe they will bite the tail. Maybe they will bite the head. You never know. And then we realize they are always going to bite the head because the orthogonal positions are easy to reach. However, if we engineer this so-called end-on coordination group nitride, you are making a very straight linear, almost like a machine, like very straight, right? You can't bend them. It's straight. So they can point always away to the CH bond, not a close-up. And that's always easy to say, but if you try to convince a close-up to do this project, it's impossible. Particularly in 2 years, they got no result. It's very hard to stay on. But in this case, we were very lucky because we had all the crystal structure and the computation study. Every time when they try to give up, I'll show them a crystal structure. Look at that. It's so close. Looks like really promising, right? And that's why they stay. And they look at the crystal structure, they go, okay, maybe we'll try another year. And eventually, 3 years later, this worked. With three postdocs for 3.5 years, this project worked. But this is not great still because I told you this is too complicated. Particularly today is not appropriate because this is a step, atom economy is terrible. I know what Barry's thinking now already in his mind. The atom economy is terrible here, okay? But let me show you the substrate table. The substrate table is enormous. Okay, and let me highlight the tri-substitute double bond. As Melanie will tell you as well, it's very hard to handle. They don't react. But this one react. Why? Because the nitrile has a weak coordination. They can do whatever they want. They touch it, see if graduation happens, double bond come in, they go away. So you have a free site to offer. So that is the trick. It works really well. But practically, this is not good. But fortunately, this principle turned into be a practical directing as well. Very simple aiming. You can buy for module, and this is the same idea as Phil. We published the paper. We already have all these catalogs. We make, you know, hundreds of grams for them to sell. Very cheap to make. And the beauty is this substrate is readily available. Hydrocyanic acid is a bulky chemical you can buy. And you can buy 270s from Aldrich. A lot of them. So it's very useful chemistry you can direct. And let me show you the goal we set out to do. All of them work. And let me point out this substrate. How do you make this kind of molecule? You block the author, methyl. And yet, this template would walk away and suddenly do a U-turn, come back. We call this a molecular U-turn and cut the CH bond selectively. That is very hard to imagine, but definitely works based on that idea. But of course, if that's the end of the story, still it's not good enough because the atomic product is still not great. We certainly have to improve. But let me show you what substrate we're interested in now. We are interested to develop auxiliary for all of that. Diphenylenes, phenylacetic acid, benzoyl acid, ketone, phenol. We just published a phenol in JAX, and that one, atomic carbon is still not great, but this is the example. But because part of the directive is already drug molecule for Pfizer, so they are happy to use it. So they have used this chemistry really well, because that's already a drug skeleton. All of those are drugs. You just, as part of this directive put on, that it works really well. But that is still a little bit too big. Because if you want to develop an auxiliary, maybe the standard is like Evans auxiliary, right? That's the ordinary auxiliary. Very easy to remove, very easy to install, and very small as well. Maybe 30% of your product. And that turns out to be absolutely possible. By taking this AMI heterocycle, all you need to do is attach the template with half of them. If I may go back. You don't need this two, you need only one. Now it's very small, very practical. You just buy the module, we didn't even make it. You just buy it already available. You can do this chemistry still. Then the atomic colony becomes a little bit better, right? It's not ideal, but it's much better, improved. Half of the auxiliary now can do it. And if you look at this chemistry, how do you do that? Doesn't matter. It's very hard to reach. But now by attaching that auxiliary, you can cleave that CH bond with very high selectivity. Okay? So that is the first part of my talk. I think it's all about SP2, and I think the key message I want to show you is a weak coordination is very powerful, and the ligand acceleration is necessary to help the transition state. But the second part is SP3. We have a huge problem still. And this was a dream reaction that we wanted to do, is take a pivotic acid and make a quaternary carbon center. By, as it stands now, it looks like we can't beat the Enon's method. Your method is by far more general, but we are still working on it. Because it's a different approach, right? For synthetic chemistry, you always need a different approach, complementary. And this is a different starting material, pivotic acid. We hope to control all the stereochemistry. The biggest problem here is this step. The stereochemistry still is not very well controlled. The best E we can get, 85. But that's not good enough for JAX. You need a 95. But let me tell you the reactivity part. The reactivity part is interesting, actually. That's what I'm going to focus upon today. So you take this pivotic acid, you Suzuki coupling, 38% yield. I remember we were rejected by JAX. But looking back, this is astonishing reactivity, in my opinion. Even 30-80% yield. How do you do that? SP3 also works. You can also use alkyl boron now to cross-couple. 30-80% yield. But of course, we have to improve, so we improve. We made another auxiliary that is used as a protecting group by Derek Barton in 98. And that is absolutely atom economy, perfectly okay. It's a simple protecting group for ester. Except we are trying to mimic the carboxy acid, but increase the Lewis specificity of the carbonyl. Now the yield is 70. And that is a very nice program in GSK for drug discovery. They made a huge library, and some of them already hit very promising candidate, because this is a drug scaffold. And indeed, this kind of basic discovery reactivity has really impacted many, many chemistry. Rhodium, lutetium, even recently copper, you can use this directly, and really all of them work. And here, I only give you maybe 10% of the examples. Although they may not mention us at all, but I think that our early discovery is important. That's 3 years ago. But this year, last year, we have seen a lot of good chemistry using this directing group. Okay, and let me show you why that's important. How does this work? But let me tell you another story. That group actually is not good anymore now, because it's good for SP2, but it's not so good for SP3, because the alpha hydrogen is too acidic if you have any methoxy amide. So we really struggle to activate the the CH bond, when you have alpha hydrogen power center. So it's a huge problem. And that's not surprising. We have a very good question from the audience from Melanie, why that happened. Because you could have alpha, actually does have alpha allylation at certain conditions, okay, like a Buckhorn's allylation. So it's very important to tune the acidity back, less acidic. Now we can do all this chemistry. So you can take the chiral molecule and hit with all kind of coupling partner to make a chiral center. But what's very important is how does this work? How does this nitrogen binding to the platinum? And if you read the literature, all the crystal structure tells you clearly what's happened is the nitrogen coordinate to platinum. But that's not going to work. Because that's going to do the amination, Buckhorn-Hollerbach amination. And they cost a huge amount of energy to assemble the transition state for CH hydration. So what's happening? Those crystal structures are very stable, very easy to get, no question. But what's really mysterious is this crystal structure. Very difficult to get, very unstable, but it's reactive. So finally, at a 0 degree crystallization, we were able to catch this X-ray structure crystal. And we believe that is a reactive species, and that mimics the carboxylic acid structure, as you know. So now we're coming back to weak coordination, dihedral, everything seems to make sense. Bless you, Barry. So this really makes sense, okay? The dihedral angle and the weak coordination comes together to favor our kinetics, okay? And of course, we still have one problem. And again, Melanie mentioned the methylene problem. It's great to have a selectivity. I remember Bergman was very happy to see my chemistry, Melanie chemistry have a primary CH bond selectivity. But it's always better to have both. Can you have a system that is selective and methylene as well? How do you do that? You need a ligand. So what's the problem? If you look into literature, these are the literature, they can do methylene. And I think the Melanie has one example, but not this kind of open chain. It was like a breathing cycling, okay? For open chain, really, Douglas chemistry is the best, most efficient. Our chemistry is kind of 22%, very low yield. Clearly, it's a big problem. So if you look at this chemistry, what's going on here? Why those examples can do CH hydration bisdentate very easily, okay? This kind of bisdentate coordination is very, very powerful. And there are many examples from South Korea in the 1990s. I don't have time to show all of them. But the bottom line is strong coordination, bisdentate coordination works for methylene CH hydration. So why? If it's entropy, as everybody believes, I believe, it's entropy, then we are all in trouble. Because then you always have to have something strong coordinating intramolecularly. Then that's not what you wanted. So we have no choice but to put forward our unlikely hypothesis. That is, the entropy maybe is wrong. It's not entropy. And remember, we debated about this, but entropy still is complicated. It may be still part of entropy, but let me tell you, we believe maybe entropy. Okay? If it's entropy, then it's great news for everybody. Because then everybody can design a ligand from outside to match the entropy. And we measured all the entropy, but it's not clear. The data is so hard to justify. But we decided to believe it anyway. We decided to believe, at least I persuade students to believe it. So believe that entropy is the key. So now look at this scheme. We really need to make this one rate, now the mountain is lower. We need, this one is high, but we need to drop that by using entropy, the ligand donation into it. But if you think about it, when I talked to Bergman and William Jones 2 weeks ago, they told me the entropy idea may be right, but also at the same time, maybe entropy still is playing a role. Why? Because the weak coordination actually is also a little bit higher ground state, can also help you to reach the transition state. And the ligand combination of the ligand with the weak coordination might also bring a more faster pre-organization. So entropically, the ligand can also help. But I think it's a mixture of entropy and entropy. But before we have the absolute data, it's very hard to conclude. But by asking the right question, the bottom line is chemistry works. Indeed. By taking this very simple weak coordinating group, now we can do methylene CH activation using this ligand. And again, this idea is based on mutual repulsive ligand. That is this structure here. Again, reversibility. You see all the species here by NMR. If you look at it, the NMR, of course, it's all is like this, particularly at 0 degree. But if you warm this up to 100 degree, you start to see a lot of species at this. At least 30%, you see this more coordinated species. Now, this guy is very friendly. They start to invite the substrate to come in to have a dance. And that's what happened. CH bond is clean, and you got this compound. So how do we utilize this new chemistry to really do some practical chemistry we have been dreaming about for years and years, 10 years now, because we knew it's a huge opportunity for manipulating amino acids. But although Douglas chemistry can do some, but I don't think it's doing very well. It's because still the longer time, the loss of nitrogen selectivity and scaling up is still very difficult. But it's a beautiful chemistry, by the way. But so it turns out, if we're using this kind of ligand, The first step, we can do really well, 92% yield now. 20 hours, that's already pretty short for this kind of chemistry. In the stereo selectivity, 98% maintained, not resomized, basically. So that's great, and we then hydrolyze this one very easily, and then convert that to Bach, FMOC, in 5-gram scale, because BMS asked us precisely 5-gram scale, providing 50 samples to them. So you have to be really working, okay? 5-gram every amino acid on natural amino acid for drug discovery. But what's really interesting is the second one. By discovering another ligand, we can do dye selectivity, so we can totally control mono and dye. So that is very interesting. It tells you the ligand is absolutely involved in the transition state. And if you measure the isolate effect, they are completely different. And I don't have time to discuss with you. It's very intriguing. But let me show you what really is exciting. The subject scope is very exciting. But what really exciting is this one-pot reaction. By using one ligand and two ligands in one pot without doing any change, you make this exotic chiral amino acid at the beta position, chiral setup, 50-to-1 diastereo selectivity. And that is very tough to make. Why? Because the hydrogenation can handle this really well if one of them is not, if one of them is not aromatic. If it's both aromatic, it's not easy to make that double bond stereochemistry control and the isomerize as well during the hydrogenation. So it's a huge problem for asymmetric catalysis, okay? But by doing this, we can make pretty much anything you want. And this is, again, the beginning. We can do Suzuki coupling now. By doing our Suzuki coupling, we can even have broader scope. Using two ligand, Suzuki coupling, whatever you want, you can make a lot of amino acids. Why this is very important? Not only BMS is paying a lot of money, as Phil said to us, for to make lots and lots of amino acids in 5-gram scale, but also, look at this natural part. Look at this ligand. I knew we all struggled, most of us struggled to make this chiral ligand, because terlucine is so expensive. But I think that this kind of ligand might stand a chance to compete, even do better than the chiral, terlucine-based chiral oxalate. And what is even better? Because we introduced another chiral center at this point, which is very hard to introduce. Now you can study remote chiral center affect maybe polymerization. We see beautiful talk, polymerization. This could be really influencing the remote for polymerization center chemistry. So we basically, based on this chemistry, we initiated another totally new direction for asymmetric catalysis based on this ligand that nobody has made before. So I think that my time is running out just about. But let me show you one more result. What about the distance, SP3? By tuning again the ligand, we were able to push to the gamma position still. We can do gamma position now as well, SP3, SP3 coupling. And that again, it's not a great reaction, but just tell you the principle, how do you do ligand control the reaction? Even olefination. You can do gamma olefination using this ligand. So this ligand is very general. And you might be wondering, the amino acid is not surprising because nobody would use that kind of distending coordinate. It's a little bit weird. But the pyrimidine seems to be explored by everybody, right? But the key is the belief, if you believe it or not. If you believe the theory, enthalpy, entropy, and you really focus exploiting that hypothesis, I think that would work. And that, I guess, speaks to the importance of hypothesis-driven research versus large number of screening. If you're doing large number of screening, how can you compete the whole world? Because everybody is screening. And if you don't have your own idea hypothesis, it's very hard to come up with something new. I don't know whether that makes sense to the student. But I think that's what I really like what Barry commented. You know, maybe for the intellectual point of view, even you don't want to stop thinking anyway, because that's the whole point of being academic, right? So, but this is a real example. By thinking about enthalpy, entropy, we made a big step forward for ligand-accelerated SP3C activation, a new ligand scaffold. But of course, most important, let me stop here by thanking whoever did the work. It's an absolutely wonderful group of students. I really can't thank them enough. And it's a long list. I can't read all of them. But I should also highlight there are always high school students every summer in my lab. And these two students both published 2 JACs in the summertime. So for those undergraduates, if you want to visit me for 3 months, maybe you can publish something in the summer. And actually, there are 2 students in the audience who are coming, is going to come. So I should also highlight the NSF Center grant that we are asked to highlight, that we really try to collaborate within the center, multiple groups collaborating together on the CHIV agent, try to push for total synthesis. But in fact, in spirits, I collaborate a lot with Phil Barron anyway for total synthesis. And finally, I want to thank Doron for the hosting me, and I want to thank Ted University. And every time, I only came here 2nd time, and I have to say, I'm extraordinarily impressed by a relatively small chemical community, how many original ideas they produce from this community, right? Original, high scholarship, and I always enjoyed visiting here and listening to, talking to the faculty members here. And finally, thank you so much for listening to me.
Thank you, Gene, for a fascinating talk. I think one thing I've learned already, and if I want to work in the field of CH1 activation, I need to speak as fast as you and anyone can speak. Anyway, we have some time for questions, please. Elon.
That is coming. Yeah, that's another program, but has still based on the same idea. It's very important to have the weak one and have the ligand. Then you can imagine how you design. It actually is totally durable. We have a result. We have very encouraging result coming in that direction. Great question. That's definitely the next step for us. Akadi.
No question. In your talk and in previous talks, you saw a lot of pyridine ligands.
Yes.
And pyridine always looks like a pyridine. Okay, it's just a ligand that coordinates, provides some space, and directs. The pyridine sometimes behaves like a non-interesting ligand. Do you think this sort of reversible aromatization, dearomatization, can play a role in some of this reaction?
Yeah. That's a great question. We certainly, okay, I'll show you the ligand structure. I did not tell you all the detail, what do we see by NMR and stuff. So that's a very good question. So I talked with David, your boss, already. So if you look at this structure, we don't believe that is happening. So this one actually is a perfect pyridine. But once we move on to the SP3, and this is what we want to actually collaborate with David Meerstein group to study the detail here. If you look at this ligand, you will notice it's very interesting. You have the alkoxide. There something is going on. That alkoxide, that lone pair, is really going in there, break the aromatic ring. And something might be going on, because the NMR signal, when they go into play, the NMR signal tells you something really is going on. It's a very complicated coupling pattern. But we don't know yet exactly what's happening. It's possible. Something maybe happened, you know, the aromatic ring is destroyed, distorted. Definitely.
Any more questions? If not, let's thank Gene once more.